Hello, my dear class 7 students. Today we will going to discuss about the chapter 4, weather and climate. Okay, what will we learn in this chapter? We will learn about the weather, what is climate, its different parameters, different elements. Okay, I am Ishita Raj. I am going to teach you about this chapter. Let's start this chapter. At first, what is climate? Climate is one of the most basic elements of the natural environment. It has a great influence on our socio-economic life. Like in our socio-cultural life, in our economic activities, even it affects the kind of clothes that we wear, the food we eat, the types of houses where we live in, even with that, the type of work we do. So these are the factors that is also determined by the climate. Like if you live in the climatic region, in the hilly region, so what we will wear is just warm clothes. Even with that, the our activity will be like the plantation agriculture is there, some shepherd are just moving with their domesticated animals. So these are the economic activities, these are the social life. The food also that are consumed by the people is also different. Even who are just living in the plain land, their food, their culture, their economic activities, all are just different from any other region. So climate is the main determinant factor of all kinds of socio-cultural, socio-economic activities that we do. Even with that, the food we consume, the clothes we wear, houses where we live in, like if you are living in the desert region, so their climate is very harsh, very hot, warm climate, and dry also, because no precipitation is there, no rainfall is there, or very little rainfall. So the house would be with that environment. Even with the stone houses are there, okay, because they are very bad conductor of heat. So climate is the main determinant factor. With that, what is weather? Weather is the day-to-day condition of the atmosphere at any place. As regards the temperature, rainfall, wind, humidity, sunshine, cloudiness, and so other many factors are there. So weather is the day-to-day condition of the atmosphere, okay? But what is climate is totally different. Weather is dynamic in nature, like it keeps changing. What does dynamic means? Static means that is not moving. And the opposite of static is the dynamic, that is always changing. The climatic condition which are right now will be changed after certain times. So in the evening, or you can say in the afternoon, you have the fair weather. Okay, you have fair weather. But after certain times, the cloud cover is there and the heavy torrential rainfall is started. So after a certain time, the rainfall will start it. So this is the change of climate. So it is always keeps changing because weather is a dynamic in nature. Thus, we can say that weather is the condition of the atmosphere, particularly in one place over a short period of time. Okay, this is the weather. Now, what is climate? So it is the dynamic in nature. With that, it keeps changing, right? But the climate is generally defined as the average state of weather over a considerable amount of time. So, which I have said that weather is always keeps changing, keeps going changing, and it is dynamic in nature. It is changing in a shorter period. Even with that, it's a atmospheric condition in a place of very shorter time. But climate is totally different, that it is also generally atmospheric condition, but this is the average state of weather over a considerable amount of time, over a longer time. You can say sometimes we just measured the climate as the 35 years, okay? We can say weather of 35 years can be considered as the climate of one place, almost 35 years. So this is the average state of weather over a considerable amount of time. Various methodical observation, recording and processing of elements such as the humidity, winds, clouds, air pressure and sunshine is done before the standardization of the climate of a region. Moreover, the climate is generally recorded for a larger region. So it is also for over a large time or over a long duration, even with that, a large region also. Okay. Like if you have the equatorial climate, then this is the very large region that is comprised of total equator. So it's a very large region. Even with that, the time period is also very large. Whereas in weather condition, we can say in a very shorter period, even with that, in a very small region also. Now we will discuss what is the basic difference between the climate and weather. It is very, very much important. And climate is also defined as the average weather condition. Those two are similar, and the average weather condition is also called as the climate. Now, what is the basic difference between the weather and climate? At first, weather is the daily change of atmospheric condition, whereas the climate is the atmospheric condition also, but that is recorded over a longer period. I have already said that the weather is a dynamic and it is keeps changing in a very short period. So it is a daily change, you can say, of atmospheric condition, but climate will not change daily. It is recorded over a long period of time. So the time duration is totally different. Even with that, number two is the weather always keeps changing, whereas the climate remains constant over a long period of time. Why it is remains constant? Because we are concerned about the long period of weather, that is climate. Almost 35 years of weather that are considered as climate. So it will not keep changing. It will remain constant over a longer period. Minute change will not be considered. But in weather condition, they are always keeps changing. Weather involves, third we have, weather involves the study of temperature, humidity, rain, wind, pressure, cloud cover, sunshine. Whereas the climate involves the study of daily weather recording over a long period of time. So the weather involves with these factors like the temperature, humidity, rain, wind, pressure. But the climate involves the study of daily weather also, but over a long time. Lastly, the difference is the study of weather is called as the meteorology, whereas the study of climate, we would say it as a climatology. Okay, this line that the study of weather is known as the meteorology, whereas the climate study is known as the climatology. So these are the basic difference between the weather and climate. Okay, now we will learn about the different parameters or different elements of the weather and climate one by one. So what are the various elements of weather? These are the elements of weather: temperature, atmospheric pressure, wind, humidity, precipitation, cloud cover, and lastly we have the sunshine. These are the basic elements of weather. We will discuss it one by one, each of that. Okay, at first we will discuss about the temperature. I have pointed out major points. First we have the temperature. The term temperature is used to express the intensity or the degree of heat. So the heat we have, the degree of heat or the intensity of heat, that is measured by temperature. Okay. So the main source of heat, what does it? It is the sun. All kind of natural source of heat energy, the main source of it is the sun. So what is insolation? You should have to remember, students, the amount of total solar energy that is received by the earth's surface is called the insolation. What does it mean? Insolation, in means incoming, so means solar, insolation, and sun is from radiation. So the incoming solar radiation, insolation, this is the incoming solar radiation, that is the total amount of energy that is received by the earth is called the insolation, and the main source of it is the sun. It varies because of the Earth's spherical shape and the inclined axis. What does it mean? Spherical, this term means the round shape or the shape like a sphere. Okay, the Earth shape like a sphere. This is the spherical shape. If you have this, this is a circle, but this is in two dimension, like in a paper. But when it is in a three dimension, it will be like a sphere. So the shape of a sphere is called the spherical shape. What does it mean? Spherical. I am not writing it properly. Okay. And inclined axis. Inclined means it is tilted. It is the Earth's axis, but it is tilted in the 23.5 degrees. Okay. In this position, the Earth is tilted like this. This is our Earth and it is tilted in this 23.5 degrees. That is why the solar radiation that varies, that are mainly received in the Earth surface, are varies. Like if you have, this is the sun. Okay, this is the sun. So the solar ray that are coming in this area are just direct sunlight. But the solar radiation that coming in this portion will be oblique. It is not direct. That is why the incoming solar radiation, the amount of incoming solar radiation will be different. Right? Okay, I am drawing it properly. Like you have, this is the sun and this is the Earth. Okay, so this portion, or you can say the equatorial portion, receives more heat because of direct sunlight is there. But the two pole region, this is the North Pole and this is the South Pole, this will get the oblique sun rays or indirect heat, indirect sunlight, right? That is why these two portion will be remain cool, or the cold region. So the main cause of the difference of heat in various places are the spherical shape of the Earth and the inclined axis. What are the determinants? Duration of the sunlight, angle of the sun rays, and latitude. Latitude, even with that, altitude is also there. Like latitudinal difference, even in equatorial region, I have already said that will receive more insolation, and in the polar region, the insolation will be decreased. Even with that, the angle of sun rays is direct in the equatorial part and it will be decreased through the pole. And the duration of sunlight, that is whenever you will have the duration is more, that get sunlight more, with more duration, so the temperature will be also high. And when you have the duration of sunlight is less, then the temperature will be also less. So these are the determinants. Lastly, the components of solar radiation. What are the components of solar radiation? They are visible light, ultraviolet rays, and the infrared rays. What are those? The wavelength, or you can say in the spectrum, the wavelength of 0.3 μm to 0.7 μm, that is the rays which we can see with our bare eyes. Okay, that is the visible light. You can say the vivgyor. Okay, the vivgyor portion we can see. But after red, there is the infrared, which we cannot see. And before V or before violet, we have the UV, or you can say the ultraviolet, that is also not seen by our bare eyes. So this much portion is called the spectrum or electromagnetic spectrum. This is the main components of the solar radiation. Vivgyor portion that we can see with our bare eyes, like violet, indigo, blue, green, vivgyor, yellow, orange and red. This much portion is the we can see with our bare eyes. And this is infrared, and before violet it is the ultraviolet. So this is the temperature we have covered. Now what is the instrument by which we can measure the temperature? Is the Six's thermometer. This is the picture where you have some idea. This thermometer was invented by James Six, and it automatically records the maximum and minimum temperature of a place during a 24 hours, means in a day we have the maximum temperature of a day. Even with that, one minimum temperature that is automatically recorded in this thermometer. This is the 6S thermometer. Next components or next elements we will discuss is the atmospheric pressure. A very, very important factor is the atmospheric pressure. So we will discuss it. Like at first we have temperature. If we have temperature, it is the main cause of getting atmospheric pressure. Why? Because what is atmospheric pressure? It is the pressure that exerted by the atmosphere on the surface of the earth. If you have a parcel of air, okay? If you have a parcel of air, like air is there. Okay, it's a parcel of air. So, it has some weight. If it has some weight, then it creates some pressure. This is called as the atmospheric pressure. So, this is a parcel of air that exerted some pressure on the surface of the earth is called the atmospheric pressure. Now, what is low pressure? What is high pressure? How it is formed? If air expands, it creates low pressure area. Like you have this much of air. Now it is expands in all direction. It is expands. So the present size of this parcel is like this much. So the density will be less. That is why it will exert low pressure. So if it will expands low pressure. Now how low pressure is created? If the temperature is high, it will create low pressure. And in the same way, if the temperature is very low, it will create high pressure. So the temperature and pressure has the negative relation. Like temperature is high, you have the low pressure. Like temperature is low, you have the high pressure. Always try to remember, temperature and pressure has two negative relation. So if we have high temperature, it will get more and more humidity. It will get more and more water vapor. That is why what will happen? The pressure will be very, very less. And the very low temperature, like you have the cold air, okay, so it exerts much pressure. That is why high pressure is created. The difference of pressure in two places causes the movement of air. This is a very important, like after atmospheric pressure, we will discuss about the wind. Here lies the main importance of wind. Like if two places have difference of pressure, like you have this is place A and this is the place B. Okay, these two places have difference in pressure. Like this is high pressure H and this is the low pressure that is L. What does it happen? Like from the high pressure region to the low pressure region, the air will be moved. So this is the place A and B. If there is some pressure differences, that is why air is also moving. Even with that, all the severe weather phenomena like tornadoes, you have the thunderstorms, any kind of cyclone is there that are associated with the atmospheric pressure. So all kind of severe atmospheric phenomena, the main culprit is the, you can say, atmospheric pressure. In the summer time, I have already said temperature is very high. So in the summer time, very, very high temperature, that is why there is created some low pressure, and a severe low pressure and very high depression is created. That is why this kind of cyclones, tornadoes that are associated. Okay. And the instrument by which we can measure the atmospheric pressure is the aneroid barometer or any kind of barometer. Nowadays, it is also used the aneroid barometer. Next, we will discuss about the third parameter, that is the wind. What is wind? It's the horizontal movement of the air. Air and wind, what is the difference? Air is always there, but when it starts flowing, it is called as the wind. So the horizontal movement of air is called the wind. The main cause of it is the unequal heating of atmosphere. I have already said what is the main causes of unequal heating, because the spherical shape of the earth, inclined axis, latitude, altitude, various factors are there. That is why unequal heating of the atmosphere, that causes the wind. Some differences in pressure is there, some differences in temperature is there. That is why the wind starts to flow, and wind blows from the high pressure to the low pressure region. Okay, unequal of heating of atmosphere, and then wind starts to blow from high pressure region to the low pressure one. The greater the difference in pressure, faster the air moves. What does it mean? If you have the pressure difference is very low, then the wind blow or the air flow is not with much velocity. But the difference when is very high, like in the time of severe weather phenomena, in the tornado, in the time of any kind of cyclone, that Umphun has already devastated our West Bengal. So the pressure differences is very high, like this is the high pressure region and this is the low pressure region. But the pressure difference between these two places will be very, very high. Then the wind will flow with a very high velocity. Okay, that will totally depends upon the difference in pressure. If it is greater, then the faster will be the air moves. Now, two instruments are there. One is wind vane and another one is the anemometer. Wind vane, that determines the direction of the wind, from which direction the winds are blown. And the anemometer, that measures the velocity, or you can say the speed of the wind. This is the picture. Just see, this is the picture. Here two instruments are there, like this is the wind vane. Okay, here all the directions are written, like from which the winds are blow. And another thing you have to remember, the name of the wind is determined by the direction from which they are originated. Like if the winds are blown from this direction, this is the direction from west side to the east side, then the wind will be called as the westerly wind. Okay, it will be called as the westerly wind. Why westerly? Because it will move from the west side. So the wind will be named after the direction by which or from which they are originated. So if the winds, so this is the direction, this is the north side. Okay, if the winds are blown from this direction, so this is south and this is west, this wind will be called as the southwest. This wind will be called as the southwest wind. Why? Because it will move from this direction. So this is the southwest. That is why the wind will be called as the southwest wind. Like in our case, the southwest monsoon is there. Okay, so this much. They are usually named after the direction from which they are originated, like southwest monsoon. You should have to remember, students, how the winds are named. Okay. Here you have two things to know. One is the Coriolis force and another one is the Farrell's law. What are these two very, very important point? These two. Coriolis force is the deflection of winds due to the rotation of the earth on its axis. So earth is the spherical shape, it is okay, but this is also tilted in 23.5 degrees, and it is also rotating over its axis, right? If the earth is totally, you suppose the earth is not moving, it is totally still, or it is totally not moving, static, then what will happen? The winds from the two poles, like this is the pole, this is the pole, the winds from these two poles will be come in the equatorial region, right? Right, the pole is of high pressure because the cold wind is there, that is, it is high pressure, and the equatorial portion is very low pressure. Why low pressure? Because very high temperature. I have already said, here the cool region, cold region, that is why high pressure. Here the warm region, that is why low pressure. Always remember, okay, that is why low pressure. So if the earth will not rotating, then the total wind comes from the north to the equatorial, even with from the south to the equatorial. But the earth is started rotating. What started? It is started to rotating. From which direction it starts rotating? From west to east. In this direction it is rotated, right? So all the winds that are come from this direction will be deflected to this side. Okay, the path of the wind they are moving is just deflected. So if they are moving from this direction, they will be deflected in the east side. And the Faraday's law that states in the northern hemisphere, the deflection will be towards the right, and in the southern hemisphere, the deflection will be to the left. This is the Faraday's law. The deflection of wind due to the Coriolis force will be in this form. This is the earth in northern hemisphere. You have the deflection in the right side, and in southern hemisphere, you have the deflection in the west side, or you can say the left side. So have some look in the picture. I think you will have some idea about that. See this picture. The rotation of the earth on its axis is just started. That is why if the wind has, okay, I will choose this color. If the wind has, this is the original path. The path, if the earth did not rotate, so this will be the original path. But as the earth is rotated from this direction, you can say from west to east, that is why this is deflected in the right side. So this is the actual wind path where they are actually moving is this direction. In the same way, in the southern hemisphere, this is the actual path. Okay, so this is the Coriolis effect and Faraday's law. For your better understanding, I have created this. Just remember this picture. In the northern hemisphere, where will be the deflection? This is in the right side. And in the southern hemisphere, this is in the left side. Or you can say in the southern hemisphere and this is in the northern hemisphere. Faraday's law or Coriolis force that states due to the earth's rotation, the wind is deflected towards these two sides. That is why all the winds in general circulations are just originated. Like the northeast trade winds, like the any kind of westerlies, polar winds, all the winds that are generated by these kinds of deflection. They are not move in the straight line. They always are deflected due to the Coriolis action.